मैडम डिप्टी चेयरमैन, फ्रॉम द स्पीचेस विच द हॉनरेबल मिनिस्टर फॉर प्लानिंग मेड इन दिस हाउस एंड इन द अदर हाउस एंड फ्रॉम अ परजुअल ऑफ द नोट विच हैज़ बीन सर्कुलेटेड टू अस रिगार्डिंग द प्रोग्रेस दैट हैज़ बीन मेड इन द 10th फाइव ईयर प्लान एंड द वेरियस स्टेटमेंट्स ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट एंड द प्लानिंग कमीशन, आई हैव अ फीलिंग दैट द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया इज ट्राइंग टू असुएज द फीलिंग ऑफ डिससेटिस्फैक्शन इन द कंट्री थ्रू promises of bright future, promises of better efforts and general promise that everything is going to turn out all right and that there need not be any fear or anxiety in the country. Madam, while saying this, I realize that the country has made certain progress in the development of our economy during the last decade. Industrial production has increased, agricultural production has increased, the productive capacity has been built up, and we have also got employment opportunities being created. Above all, we have gained valuable experience in the development of our economy, especially in planning, and these are all to the credit side of the plan. Unfortunately, madam, the price that we have paid for this progress is rather heavy. The imbalances that we have created are likely to go out of control unless definite steps are taken to see that the imbalances are corrected at the earliest opportunity. The problem of the distribution of income that is generated as a result of the development efforts in the country is a perennial question and comes up again and again in one form or the other before this house, and though I realize that no definite opinion is possible unless we have got some authoritative data and analysis on the subject, there is clear indication of the fact that if not economic wealth, at least economic power is being concentrated in fewer and fewer hands. As long as economic power is concentrated in such few hands, it will not be possible for us to develop in the manner in which we like, whatever may be our regulatory and control apparatus, whatever may be our policy, whatever may be the objectives that we place before the country. Similarly, the imbalance between the rural and the urban sector is also increasing. I do not know whether in the rural areas some income has been pumped in as a result of our planned development. It is possible that the well-to-do peasants, the richer peasants, might have benefited as a result of our economic development, but as far as the rural area as a whole is concerned, the disparity and imbalance is definitely growing, and that is also a matter of concern. The very fact that urbanization takes place at such a rapid rate in our country is visible proof that the imbalance has been growing, with the result that neither the urban areas nor the rural areas are today in a position to live the life that they were living before our planned developmental efforts started. Now there is over congestion in the urban areas. The civic amenities are all on the point of breaking down, and they continuously break down with the slightest accident here or there. The slums are increasing at a rapid rate, and unemployment is increasing. Whatever may be the figures regarding crimes, etc., that may be punished by the government, there is a definite impression in the country that the crime situation is also deteriorating. That is because of the congestion in the urban areas. Because of the difficulties due to lack of resources, they are unable to deal with the problems that arise as a result of this over congestion, and the problem of law and order becomes more acute as a result of this urbanization. Thirdly, the question of unemployment has also taken a rather serious turn, and when the government spokesman addressed homilies to others regarding the agitation against high prices and higher taxes, they completely forget that year by year one earner has to support more and more people, and we have got the authority of no less a person than the planning minister himself to say that the real income of the earner, at least in the lower income groups, has not risen, and in spite of that, that earner has to support a larger and larger number of dependents. There is so much dissatisfaction in the country that people are clamoring against rising prices and rising taxes. The planning minister has given us a frank picture regarding what has happened in the first year of the 10th plan period, and we are grateful to him for this frank picture. The figures that he has cited have given us a clear idea of what is happening to our economy at the present moment. But he has tried to strike a note of optimism. He has tried to explain the reasons that are responsible for this state of affairs, and he has also indicated that the Planning Commission is conscious of all these drawbacks. The crux of the whole matter, therefore, is the inability on the part of the government to manipulate the prices in a manner whereby it may be possible to achieve crop planning in order to achieve the desired results. As long as this price structure is allowed to move in the manner in which it is moving today, whatever may be the policy of the government, however so much credit they may pump into the agricultural sector, whatever the amenities they may give to the agriculturists, it will not be possible for us to achieve the targets in the manner in which we want to achieve. I would have been satisfied if, as a result of this increased agricultural production, the farmer was better off. But we find that whenever there is increased production in response to higher prices, the markets slump down so heavily that ultimately the farmer stands to loss instead of to gain. Therefore, the farmer loses both ways and the country also loses. The farmer puts in more money, more resources in the production of crops for which he expects higher returns, and he loses all that money because the prices are not rising to his expectations, and instead of the prices fall down rather precipitously, and the country is also losing because there is a very uneven development of agriculture. Therefore, the crux of the whole problem is not just to hold the price line or just to see that black marketing is avoided. That is only one part of the job, a very important part of the price policy, and that has got to be kept in mind. I am not against it. In fact, I am all for it, and I blame the government for not being able to do it so far. But this is another aspect of the price policy to which the Planning Commission, it seems to me, has not applied its mind properly so far, namely the use of price policy as an instrument of crop planning. And as long as that particular tool is not utilized for this objective, it will not be possible for us to have a planned development of our economy. Then there is the question of incentives. We are now told every time that unless incentives are given, it will not be possible for us to development of our economy. We are hearing daily about our export promotion. Now the problem of incentives also has to be viewed in terms of the objective of the development of a socialist economy in our country, and not just from the point of view of earning more and more foreign balances. I am not in any way violating the problem of foreign balances, but ultimately the problem of foreign balances has significance and meaning only in terms of the objectives that the 10th plan has set before it. Therefore, when we are talking of incentives in order to earn more foreign balances, we have also to think of incentives in terms of achieving the objectives that we have got in mind. I was therefore disappointed to read the speech of the planning minister, as he said as the planning minister at the Indian Labour Conference, in which he seems to have indicated a new approach to the problem of wages. His approach has passed through three stages. In the first stage, just after the general election, the planning minister came out with a statement that he was thoroughly dissatisfied with the way in which the wage structure had developed and that he meant to do something about it. He categorically stated that the real wages had not increased because of intransigence of the management, and he further stated that he wanted to do something about it. Then there came about a discussion as to what could be done, and all the industrialists themselves and the financial newspapers in this country came out with the theory that wages could be increased only if productivity is increased, and therefore wages should be linked with productivity. That was the second stage. Increase productivity and wages will be increased. That was the slogan, and that was the principle which was accepted even by the industrialists. But what do we find in the speech of the planning minister to the Indian Labour Conference? There he says that even if productivity increases, the first charge will be in respect of projects which are meant for further employment or creation of more employment opportunities. That means even if productivity increases, it is not that the workers will immediately benefit in terms of higher wages, so that it may be possible for them to improve their standard of living a little bit. Even if productivity rises, the fruits of productivity will go to schemes for creating further employment opportunities in the country. How long are the workers to wait, and what exactly will be the stage at which it can be stated that enough employment opportunities have been created and therefore the stage has come for increased wages?